भद्रं कर्णेभिःशृणुजामदेवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टुपागुंसस्तनूभिः यशेम देवहितं यदाजुः स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
ॐ नमः प्रणवार्थाय शुद्धज्ञानैकमूर्तये निर्मलाय प्रशान्ताय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। यन्नित्यमानन्दमनन्तमेकं शिवेति नाम्ना श्रुतयो गृह्णन्ति तस्यावतारो नररूपधारी कृपासुदाब्धी भुवि रामकृष्णः। जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयो श्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः। नमः श्रीयतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे यैरिमे गुरुभिः पूर्वं पदवाक्यप्रमाणतः व्याख्याता सर्ववेदान्ताः तान्नित्यं प्रणतोऽस्म्यहं। यस्यात्मभूतस्य गुरोः प्रसादात् अहं विमुक्तोऽस्मि शरीरबन्धात्। सर्वोपदेष्टुः पुरुषोत्तमस्य तस्याङ्ग्रियुग्मं प्रणतोऽस्मि नित्यम्। भञ्जन दुःख घञ्जन करुणाघन कर्म कठोर प्राणार्पण जगत तारण कृंदन कलिडोर। वी आर सीइंग दि फिलोसॉफिकल एनालिसिस ऑफ फिफ्थ श्लोक ऑफ आरत्री सांग। द जनरल मीनिंग इज O Lord, you are the destroyer of human misery. You are the embodiment of mercy. You have done arduous actions. You sacrificed your life for the good of the world. You have cut asunder the bonds of Kali. In the last class, we saw that human life is with happiness and misery. Both are inevitable. No one can avoid. Even a jnani cannot avoid misery. But Vedanta Shastram analyzes this misery and gives out a way to get freedom from misery. What is the way? Gaining self-knowledge is the way. Vedanta has classified human misery into three types: adhyatmika, adi bhautika, adi daivika. Misery born out of oneself, misery born out of society, and misery born out of unseen natural forces. Misery born out of oneself is called adhyatmika tapam. We saw in the last class that because of self-ignorance and because of adharma, human being gets suffering. Absence of knowledge and absence of discipline are the sources of misery to the human life. Absence of knowledge about oneself, absence of knowledge about dharma and adharma, and adharmic actions, all put together give rise to misery that is called adhyatmika tapam. Therefore, Vedanta asks humanity to be dharmic. At the age of 7, when a child is initiated into Vedic way of life through Upanayana, it gives a command: satyam vada dharmam chara matru devo bhava pitru devo bhava acharya devo bhava atithi devo bhava. These are all commandments. You should conduct your life in this way alone. Yan yanavadyani karmani tani sevitavyani no itarani. Whatever has to be followed, that has to be followed, not the unwanted behavior. Like that, it gives instruction. But what happens? We are not exposed to this type of education system nowadays. And even if we are exposed to this type of teachings, human mind is not convinced about the validity of values, about the necessity of morality and ethics, about the necessity of dharma, about the necessity of discipline. Human mind is not convinced. Therefore, it goes for adharma. It succumbs for adharma. So, Vedanta says, first make your life disciplined. Learn. And go and see people, go and live with people who are living a disciplined life. Then slowly, you will have various types of experiences wherein you find that whatever comes in your life is subject to arrival and departure. So you cannot hold on those things which are subject to arrival and departure. So you will have a search for a constant entity in your life, and that constant entity will be a spiritual entity. Anything material, including this body, is subject to arrival and departure. Pariksha lokan karma chitan brahmano nirvedam ayat. If you are a brahmanaha, if you are a thinking person, observing person, learning person, then nirvedam ayat. You will have this clarity of thinking. What is the clarity of thinking? Nasti akrita kritene. I am not going to get something which I am seeking. What I am seeking in life? I am seeking in life an unconditional happiness. Nothing else I seek. No one seek even Bhagavan. Even Bhagavan is not sought after. If at all Bhagavan is sought after, that is because of the faith that if I get Bhagavan, I will have unconditional happiness. So in Bhagavatam class, I used to tell a simple joke. Everybody goes to Tirupati, waits for darshan in queue for 15 hours. So after going there, what happens? 30 seconds, jargandi. Suppose Bhagavan standing there with a stick and asks, 30 seconds means 2 beatings, 1 minute means 4 beatings. How many seconds you want to stay here? What will tell? Not even 2 seconds, Bhagavan. I have come here to get rid of beatings. Even after coming here, if you say that I will get beating, so I don't want you. That's what Upanishad says, Atmanastu kamaya sarvam priyam bhavati. Nava are devanam kamaya deva priya bhavanti. Atmanastu kamaya devanapi priya bhavanti. Even Ishvara is loved for the sake of unconditional happiness. How I am going to get? Shastra says, Nasti akritaha kritene. You are not going to get. Because if you get anything, it is going to be arrival and departure. It is going to be in the segment of arrival and departure. So you are seeking something which is permanent. If it is permanent, it should be here and now. Find out whether you have this through knowledge. Find out that entity which exists always, unconditionally. Because unconditional happiness can be given by unconditional entity only. What are the conditions? What are the limitations? Desha kala vastu paricheda. Space-wise limitation, time-wise limitation, and property-wise limitation. That which doesn't have all these three limitations will be source of unconditional happiness. So you cannot get it by doing some action. If at all it is available, it must be available here and now. How to get that? Through knowledge. Whatever is available here and now, we can get only through knowledge only. Param chet jnatavyam, aparam chet praptavyam, Bhagavan Shankaracharya says. If it is param, you cannot get it. You should know it, that you are already. Aparam chet, if it is something not param, if it is conditional, then you can work for getting. So how to get it? तद्विज्ञानार्थं स गुरुम् एव अभिगच्छे नास्ति अकृतकृतेन तद्विज्ञानार्थं स गुरुम् एव अभिगच्छे समित्पाणिहि श्रोत्रियं ब्रह्मनिष्ठम् सो यू कैन गेट रिड ऑफ सफरिंग विच इज caused by your own indiscipline and your own ignorance. Once you gain the knowledge, whatever may come in your life, you will not be affected. Vedanta doesn't guarantee after knowledge you will not get trouble at all. It doesn't say. You will get lots of trouble. Even if you get lots of trouble, you will not be affected. Because the knowledge is there that you are not body-mind complex. All troubles, all miseries belong to body-mind complex. I don't have any trouble and misery. That's what in Bhagavan Krishna's life we see. Before his arrival into this world, he had a life threat. Terrorists are ready. And the day one onwards, varieties of terrorists come. We don't find anywhere Krishna cried or even afraid of. How it was possible? Bhagavan says, it is because of knowledge. So that is the solution for getting rid of adhyatmika tapam. Then second tapam is adi bhautika tapam. Troubles born out of surroundings. Misery born out of surroundings. From mosquito onwards, it starts. Relatives, wealth, then power, position, all whatever you gain in your life appears to be a source of happiness at one particular time, then proves that it is not a source of happiness. That's what a jnani says. Whatever you list in your life as the source of happiness, same thing I will prove that it is the source of unhappiness. Bhoge roga bhayam kule chuti bhayam vitte nrupalat bhayam mane dainya bhayam bhale ripu bhayam rupe jaraya bhayam shastre vadi bhayam gune khala bhayam kaye krutantat bhayam sarvam vastu bhayanvitam bhuvinna vairagyameva bhayam. He says, bhoge roga bhayam. Generally, bhoga is source of happiness. Everybody considers. When ice cream comes means, everybody jumps. When cinema comes means, everybody jumps. So he says, bhoge roga bhayam. Kule chuti bhayam. If anyone is arrogant because of his superior kula, chuti bhayam. In that very kula, children will burn, who will destroy the very kula itself. That was the fact with Krishna's kula, Vrishni kula, wherein Bhagavan himself born, Bhagavan's own son, was the cause of kula nasha. His name was Samba, Jambavati's son. So kule chuti bhayam, vitte nrupalat bhayam. Lot of wealth is there means lot of happiness, everybody thinks. Here Bhartrihari says, the tax collectors will come, CBI will come. Vitte nrupalat bhayam, CBI will come. Whether they come or not, you will be worrying about their arrival. Like that he lists, then finally he says, sarvam vastu bhayanvitam. Whatever you list in your life, that I will show bhayanvitam. Then is there anything which is free from this framework? Vairagyameva bhayam. Ready to give up anything, whatever you have in your life. Need not give up. Readiness to give up. When it says, I am going to go, okay. One cannot desire to be free from problems from the surrounding. Srishti means problem. Anityam. Asukam lokam, Bhagavan told. What is the definition of this loka? Anityam, asukam lokam. Anitya means subject to arrival and departure. Even the moment which he stays for some time, that moment also is asukam. So, adi bhautika tapam also is born out of ignorance alone. As long as I consider myself as a particular individual with particular body mind complex, then only I will get problem from the surroundings. When mosquito bites, that will be source of unhappiness. When? In jagradavastha only. When a person loses his physical identity in deep sleep, how many mosquitoes bite? Go to the beach road, nearly 1,000 people are sleeping on the pavement. So much of mosquitoes. Inside the room itself, we cannot handle those mosquitoes. These fellows are very happily sleeping. What is the secret? Because the idea of body has gone, therefore nothing troubles them. That doesn't mean that all the time human being opt to sleep. You cannot sleep. So Shastra says, while waking, you can get rid of this idea of body-mind complex if you have knowledge about yourself. Adi daivika tapam, suffering born out of unseen natural forces, nobody can avoid. Even Bhagavan cannot avoid. So Bhagavan doesn't interfere in this at all. He can interfere only with regard to adhyatmika and adibhautika. First two only he can interfere. First solution is what? Self-knowledge. But all cannot have self-knowledge. Therefore, Bhagavan offers a helping hand. As long as you don't get self-knowledge, I am here to help you. I am here to teach you this knowledge. Through Guru Parampara, through Shastra Pramana, this teaching is available. But when the teaching is lost in the society, Bhagavan himself comes to this world taking a human form. That is called avataraha. So Bhagavan's avatara is to destroy adi bhaudika tapam and adhyatmika tapam. To destroy the suffering born out of social condition and born out of one's own indiscipline and ignorance, he comes to human world. In Gita he says, paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. So I come to this world, sambhavami. Even though I need not take a body, but purposefully I take a body. Even though I don't have anything to gain or lose. Name parthasti kartavyam trishulokesh kinchane nanavaptam avaptavyam vartayevacha karmani. We all go for something, try to get rid of something with the idea that this is the source of happiness and this is the source of unhappiness. Towards the source of happiness, we all go. From the source of unhappiness, we want to get rid of. So our actions have this type of motives. But Bhagavan says, I have nothing to gain, nothing to lose. Still, I come here and try to establish dharma in the society. Because social condition should be conducive enough to practice dharma. Entire apple basket is rotten. One or two are in good condition. So how to protect? So you have to throw away all the rotten apples. Who will do that? Owner of the basket will come and do it. Similarly, when the society is full of rotten people, Bhagavan comes and weeds them out. So paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam, like that he says. So first condition is creating a conducive atmosphere. Second condition is teaching those people who want to practice discipline and who want to gain self-knowledge. Creating conducive atmosphere means destroying the people, throwing out people from the society who are disturbing. And second one, keeping his own life as a model life to the society. The absence of model person in the society will not give faith to people who want to follow dharma. Recently, I had been to a college and I asked the students, how many of you are confident enough to lead a disciplined, hard working, honest life. 400 students were there. Only 2 students raised their hand. Then I asked the reason. They told, we don't see anyone who has won the life by being honest, being hard working. Like that they told openly. Then I told, your own mother is there in your home. Because she is honest, you have a mother. Because she is hardworking, she has sent you to college. Can't you see these people who are honest and hardworking next to you? They are not ready to accept that. One fellow told, my mother may be a honest and hardworking, but mother is not a winner. See? That means what? You have to define what is winning. Now the definition is, winning scale is what? Few crores of rupees of bank balance, ownership for few flats and BMW car, if possible one MLA MP seat. That's what winning scale. But our culture never considered all these things as a winning factor at all. So in our Vedic culture, the winning factor is, are you happy? That's the question. Are you happy? How much you are happy? How much you are independent? Sarvam paravasham dukkam, sarvam atmavasham sukham. Winner must be a happy person. No winner can be unhappy. So sarvam paravasham dukkam, sarvam atmavasham sukham. So the scale to judge a person's win is unconditional happiness, independent life. So people are leading a dependent life, dependent on few people, little wealth and positions like that. Once you take away those things, they are at the bottom of the creation, like that. So Shastra says that Bhagavan comes and helps the society, helps the people who want to practice discipline and who want to gain knowledge. That's what in Gita Bhagavan says, Imam vivasvate yogam proktavan aham avyayam vivasvan manave praha manurikshvagave bravit evam parampara praptam imam rajarshayo viduhu sakale nehamahata yogo nashtav parantapa. This knowledge which was taught by me to Surya has come through Guru Parampara, but mahata kalena nashtaha, therefore I have assumed this body to revive this knowledge parampara. So this dharma sthapanam at 2 levels. One is sadhu paritranam, first level. Second one is dushta nashanam. Sadhu paritranam is done by shastra rakshanam and dharmi rakshanam, protecting the shastra, which is the source of knowledge about dharma, and protecting the people who want to live dharmic life. Not only that, he keeps his own life as a model life. Yad yadacharati sreshtaha tatta devetaro janaha sayat pramanam kurute lokastadanu vartate. Arjuna, being a kshatriya, you should be a model person in life. Being a king, you should be a model person in life. See me, how I am model. Like that Bhagavan quotes himself. Then second level of dharma sthapanam is dushta nashanam. This dushta nashanam is not the purpose, but it had to be done. The dushta nashanam is done in 2 ways. One way is sattvic method, second way is rajasic and tamasic method. The sattvic method is counseling with the dushtas, counseling with the terrorists. One or two may get rid of that idea of terrorism. But when counseling fails, Bhagavan takes sticks. In every avatara, he comes with one type of weapon. In Rama avatara, Kodanda. In Krishna avatara, Chakra. So, the sattvic method was followed if the avatar's body is a sattvic body, if the avatar's birth is in a sattvic family. If the avatar's birth is in rajasic family, kshatriya family, then the kshatriya method is used. So if you see Bhagavan Sri Ram Krishna's life, the body of Sri Ram Krishna was from sattvic family. So whole life he tried to change the people, cantankerous people. He never took a stick. So dukkha nashanam by Sri Ram Krishna was re-establishing the proper infrastructure, conducive society to follow dharma, then providing model life of dharma, his own life as a model life. Then third one is re-establishing the teaching of age-old Vedic pramanam. When Sri Ram Krishna came to this world, the condition of the society, especially Indian society, was something very, very undesirable. Swami Sharadanandaji Maharaj explains the background of the Sri Ram Krishna's birth, the social background. In such a situation, Bhagavan assumed the body and established dharma. And it is not a easy task. It was an arduous task. Therefore, Swamiji also says, karma kator. In the shloka, first line, last word, karma kator is there. He has done katora karma. What is that arduous action he did? Establishing dharma in the society was arduous action done by Bhagavan Sri Ram Krishna. In Ramavatara, cantankerous people like Ravana were very few. And they were out of the society, out of Vedic society. So he had to handle them outside. In Krishna Avatara, they were inside the Vedic society. Numbers are less. But in Ramakrishna Avatara, the very Vedic society itself got corrupted. So re-establishing dharma in their mind and in the society was a arduous task, which was explained by our Sharadanandaji Maharaj. He says, in 19th century, India was in a very, very peculiar condition, because already India has gone through 1,000 years of slavery. First Islamic conquest was in 636 AD near Bombay. It happened. Very strong Islamic state was established in India in 13th century. What is the meaning of establishing Islamic state? You all know. All the temples were destroyed, forcible conversions, genocides, and if you are going to practice Vedic religion, you have to pay extra tax, like that. And after Islamic conquest, Western conquest happened in the 15th century. So because of this continuous slavery for nearly 1,000 years, India had lots of problems. The problems were analyzed from two standpoints. One is external, another one is internal. External to the Vedic culture, and the problems which are in the very Vedic culture itself. So Sharadanandaji Maharaj says, from the external standpoint, like Islam, Christianity also was a converting religion, declaring all other religions are false. And they prescribed a theocratic God with a belief system. This is what God you should believe. If you don't believe, you are called a pagan. You are called infidel. You don't have right to live in this world. Either you come to my religion or I will disturb you. Like that, power was there with them. So they were very adamant. But in the Vedic culture, what is the idea of God? It accommodates all the ideas of God. From the idea of tribal God up to the Advaitic idea of God is accommodated in the Vedic culture. But because of this slavery, because of this conquest, India suffered. Because power was there with them. Therefore, they started destroying the temples and people and scriptures. During British period, there was one Macaulay. So he was sent to India to make Indian culture as a slave culture permanently. So he has gone through all over India, 3-4 years he has traveled, then he has designed a plan and he quotes in British Parliament that even though India was full of divisions based on caste and religious beliefs and ceremonies, temples, but still Indians are united based on one thing, based on their philosophy that Ekam Sat Vipra Bahuta Vadanti. Truth is one, you can interpret in any way, and each soul is potentially divine. These type of ideas are there very strongly. Unless we destroy the culture and the philosophy which is supporting this culture, we cannot conquer this nation. So he introduced an educational system wherein no one will be taught about this culture. Nothing will be told about this culture. The glorious periods of this culture will not be told. Therefore, the language, the medium of teaching was simply stopped. What was the medium of teaching in those days? Sanskrit was the medium of teaching. So it was dumped and new medium of teaching was introduced, English medium. Therefore, our children learned a lot of Shakespeare, but they did not know anything about Vyasacharya or Shankaracharya. Now also that is the condition, unfortunate condition. But in those days it was very rampant. At least now you have some chances of learning. In those days there was no chance at all to learn what about your culture. So Sanskrit was declared as a dead language. Scriptures were twisted. Once you don't know Sanskrit, naturally you will be dependent on translation. So the translation work also they did. There was one Max Muller who translated entire Vedic text into English. Lot of twists and turns he had done and declared this is a dead culture. 50 volumes were there. So citizens were not exposed to real India and its philosophical cultural wealth. Therefore, Indians lost interest in their spiritual life and religious life. And 19th century, everywhere fighting between British and French, then fighting between Hindus, Muslims and Christians, then fighting within Hinduism, Vaishnava, Shaiva, Shakta, like that, then fighting between members of the family inside a house, male and female. Women were oppressed, they were not at all given education. So like this, from family unit onwards up to the national level, the fighting, quarrel. So India was full of chaos. It has lost faith in spiritual nature of human being. If an husband has faith in the spiritual nature of wife, can he mistreat his wife? Simple question. Can he deny the basic rights of his spouse, his wife? That was a sign that India has lost faith in spiritual nature of every individual. If society has faith in the spiritual nature of individual, can this Indian society declare one part of the society as untouchable? What is the Vedic revelation? Sarvam Kaluitam Brahma. Everything is nothing but the manifestation of the Lord. Even the Vishnu Sahasranama, which he chants daily, the first name is Vishwam Vishnuhu. Daily he chants. In those days Orthodox people used to chant lot. The very chanting shows that Vishwam Vishnuhu. But he could not recognize. When Swami Vivekananda came to South India, when he came to Kerala, he saw a scavenger was drumming and says, "Scavenger is coming, scavenger is coming." He was shouting. And all the people are running away. All the people shut their doors. So Swamiji saw that condition and said, told, this Kerala has become mental hospital. One part of the community were elite. They were talking in Sanskrit, studying scriptures, doing big pujas. But another part of their community life was humiliating the society. So therefore, the society was full of hatred. Hatred based on religion. Hatred within one's own religion based on sectarianism. Hatred based on caste. Then hatred based on gender. So this was the social condition. Already the Westerners and the Islamic culture has destroyed the basic state, and our own people gave into it and lost the faith in spiritual nature of human being, lost the faith in spiritual goal, lost the faith in scriptural teachings. In that condition, Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna manifested. So he established dharma in society by leading a truthful, pure life. Entire life was with full of purity. And he refused to go to this type of breadwinning education. Now the purpose of education is campus selection and employment. Everybody say. 150 years before, Sri Ramakrishna asked, why should I go for education? They told, you will get employment. Oh, education which will give employment, I don't want. Then what for education? If it helps me to live a proper life, then I will go for that education. So, Sri Ramakrishna refused to go for any other educational system than the Vedic educational system. What was the Vedic educational system? The center of human life must be spiritual goal. One should lead day-to-day life holding to the God. From morning to night, from waking up to the going to sleep, whole activities of human life is religious and spiritual. That was the vision of Veda. That's why as even a person gets up, he should ask pardon from Mother Earth. Oh Mother Earth, I am going to put my feet on you. Therefore, please forgive me. If he goes for brushing, there is a mantra. If he goes for bathing, there is a mantra. Sukta is there. Aghamarshana Sukta it is called. So the mundane activities of human life also was considered as religious. So there is no scope for living a materialistic life at all. But what to do? Because of external conquest and because of internal quarrels, Vedic society lost faith in Vedic way of life. Therefore, Sri Ramakrishna decided and declared that I am going to verify the validity of the scripture. The scripture says that the Mrunmayi, the Kali, statue of Kali is Bhagavan. I am going to verify. Is it Mrunmayi or Chinmayi? I am going to verify. 4 years he cried and cried and cried. That revealed, I appear to be Mrunmayi. Mrunmayi means a statue made up of mud. I appear to be Mrunmayi, but in reality, I am Chinmayi. Nothing in the creation is Jadam. Everything is Chetanam. That was the revelation. Not only his spiritual life was with verification, his day-to-day life, transaction with others also was full of examinations. So he wanted to test himself whether he has ahankara based on kula. So he appointed a day to go to a scavenger's house. In his absence, without his knowledge, he cleaned the toilet of a scavenger and came back to be satisfied that I don't have caste pride. Can anyone even imagine? He wanted to test himself whether I have respect for women, whatever may be they are, whether I can see divinity in them, whatever may be their lifestyle, whatever may be their caste, whatever may be their age. So varieties of occasions we find in Sri Ramakrishna's life, he simply reveres women. Whether that woman is in the form of his own physical mother, or that woman is his own wife, or the woman is a servant maid. One day, he happened to see a scavenger woman. As even she appeared in that temple campus, everybody ran away. Because seeing is papam. That was the condition. So Sri Ramakrishna goes towards her and prostrates to her. He addresses that woman as Divine Mother. Says to her, Mother, you alone can do this work. You alone can do this type of scavenging work. Because you consider all human beings as your children. Therefore, as mother, you are doing this like that, he was addressing. And his love for his own physical mother was extraordinary one. And his love for his wife, Sarada Devi, was most extraordinary one. He never considered her as his wife. He considered her as either his disciple or divine mother. He gave a pedestal wherein divine mother was to be installed. He asked her to sit there and worshipped. Literally, Shodashi Puja he did. That was the reverence given to women. And his life was full of accommodative nature. Many types of people came to him. Educated, illiterate, noble, cantankerous, rich, poor. Varieties of people came. His love for all of them was same. Noble people like Swami Vivekananda, Brahmananda came to him. Cantankerous people like Girish Chandra Ghosh and Kalipada Ghosh also came to him. Educated people like Keshav Chandra Sen and Vidyasagar came to him. Illiterate people like Adbhudananda came to him. Adbhudananda Ji Maharaj could not even write an alphabet. He was a shepherd boy. Sri Ramakrishna tried to teach him, but failed. If at all Sri Ramakrishna failed, that was in this project. So, the love for humanity, the very transaction, the nature of transaction was with full of nobility, love and accommodative nature. So, he established spirituality by verifying that spiritual revelations of Veda or Vedanta in his own life and declared to the world that there is God and there is God alone. There is nothing other than God in this creation. All living beings are manifestations of that one God. Therefore, his relationship with the humanity, with the animals, with the nature was full of love and compassion. He could not reject anyone. He could not have even scolding words for fallen people even. Even to fallen people, he did not have scolding words. And in his family life, he considered the members of the family as very divine. So, this was the lifestyle of Sri Ramakrishna. Because of this Vedic way of lifestyle, because of this demonstration, that Vedic way of lifestyle is still valid. If one decides to follow this, he will reach the ultimate goal of human life. That, what is that ultimate goal of human life? Unconditional happiness. That is why even after getting throat cancer, he did not bother about that disease. 20 hours he used to speak to disciples having throat cancer. Even with a good throat also, one cannot talk 20 hours. With throat cancer, he used to talk 20 hours to the disciples. Doctors used to say, don't talk, it will aggregate. Sri Ramakrishna told, anyhow, this body is going to go away. Let it go for the benefit of the humanity. That was his sacrifice. That sacrifice was told in the shloka as Pranarpane Jagata Tarane. Pranarpane Jagata Tarane. You have sacrificed your very life itself for the sake of Uddharana, for the sake of protection of the society. And that sacrifice is something very, very difficult to do. Karma Kathor. Giving up everything in life, he decided to verify the validity of the scriptures and its philosophies, way of life and culture. He inspired the general society to live with devotion. If you read Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, you will find so many Vedic teachings are given in the form of small, small similes. So one should lead this Vedic life and find out the solution for human suffering as I have found out. What is the solution for human suffering? At the initial stage, dharma is the solution. By leading a dharmic life, devoted life, one can get rid of 90% of problems in the life. When problems come also, they will not have the capacity to affect us. Shastra doesn't say problem will not come. Problem will come, but it will not touch you. As long as it doesn't touch me, I will be happy only. So, dharma gives freedom from, relative freedom from suffering. And ultimate freedom from suffering comes in the form of self-knowledge that I am not this body-mind complex. If I know that I am not this body-mind complex, what is there to disturb me? Who will disturb me? That's why Shastra says, Dvidiyadvai Bhayam Bhavati. If you know that you are the only reality in the entire creation, if you know that there is no second entity at all as a real entity, you will not have fear. Can anybody fear about the shadow? Nobody will have fear. Why? Even though it has some form, even though it walks with you, but still you will not have fear. Why? You know that it is not a reality. Will anybody fear cinema terrorist? Nobody will fear cinema terrorist. Cinema villain is a villain. Do we fear about him? No. Why? Because we know that is a mere shadow. Once the reality of a thing is denied, once the thing is revealed as a unreal, mere appearance, unreal means mere appearance, then you will not have fear at all. That was the solution given by Sri Ramakrishna through the avatara, and he established faith in the hearts of the people, he established faith in the society towards a dharma, and established a faith in the spiritual seekers to follow the spiritual life. All these things were very, very difficult to do, but Sri Ramakrishna achieved it. That karma kator, the actions which are very, very difficult to perform, he performed. To that success, he gave up his entire life. Pranarpane Jagata Tarane Krundana Kali door. He cut asunder the Kali. Kali means a quarrelsome society, quarrelsome family, quarrelsome mind. Kali means a quarrel. Full of conflicts. A person who is adharmic will have full of conflicts. A society which is adharmic will have conflicts. A religion which perpetuates adharma will have conflicts. But Sri Ramakrishna established that Vedic dharma, Vedic scripture, Vedic way of life is free from conflicts. There is no room for you to fight with anyone. There is no room for you to even blame anyone. There is no room for you even to blame yourself. There is no possibility of cry at all in this human life. That is a Vedic teaching. If at all a human being cries, he is an idiot. First shloka of Gita, Bhagavan says this. Ashochyananna shochastam prajnavadamsha bhashase gatasun agadan socha nanushochanti pandita panditaha nanushochanti. Intelligent people will not cry. Generally our cry is for either departed souls or living people. He says gatasun agadan socha. Gatasun means departed souls. So we cry for departed people or living people. Bhagavan says for both you cannot cry. Then for whom I should cry? You cannot cry for anyone. For me, for you also you cannot cry. Because you are akanda vastu ananda atma brahma puccham pratishta. You are ananda atma. You cannot cry because you find some problem with you. You cannot cry because you find problem in the society or family. If at all you cry, you are an idiot. So, Sri Ramakrishna cut asunder the Kali. Kali means the divisions, the quarrels, the sufferings in the human society and human personal human life by establishing the Vedic way of life, which happened to be very, very difficult thing to do because the background, because 19th century was full of fightings and quarrels and quarrels. To establish that dharma in society, in people's mind, to establish faith in people's mind with regard to the validity of scriptural teaching and purpose of life as spiritual one, Sri Ramakrishna gave up his entire life. Why you did? Because Karunagane, you are your embodiment of compassion. That was glorified by Swami Vivekananda in this shloka. Bhanjane dukkha ganjane karunagane karmakator pranarpane jagatatarane krindane kalitor. O Lord, you have given up your entire life in order to establish Vedic dharma in the society, which happened to be very, very difficult task to do, but you have done it. You have destroyed the Kali, suffering in the society and suffering in the human life. Therefore, my namaskaras to you. Like that, Swamiji glorifies. More details we will see in the next class. Niranjanam nityam anantarupam bhaktanukampadrita vigraham vai ishavataram paramesha medyam tam ramakrishnam sharasanamami. ओम शांति 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 हरि ओम तत्सद श्री रामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु.